Hi, I'm Engineer Bill. Thanks for joining me on this project. The challenges for this job would be considered extensive. Completely replumbed, completely rewired, moving load-bearing walls, lowering the ceiling height, soundproofing one of the walls, and adding a door to the backyard. From start to finish, this project took me, believe it or not, 2 weeks. Now, project duration is an important consideration. If I had this done by others, it would have taken 2 months at least, and cost nearly 15 times as much. So many trades would normally need to be involved in this project: the plumber, the electrician, the tile setter, the engineer for the load-bearing wall issue, demolition crew, painter, finish carpenter, and the contractor, of course. I was able to accomplish so much in a short time because of efficiencies. When one skill set was accomplished, the next skill set was right there ready to start. Of course, that was me. This project was so involved that it would scare away even experienced hands-on homeowners. But really, none of it is that hard with a little guidance. Just took this out about 30 seconds ago. So no problem. Cast iron. It only weighs about 2 tons. After clearing the debris, the fourth day was spent with a rented jackhammer to break up the foundation floor. I'm going to reposition the bathtub and shower, and I've already started having pinhole leaks in the existing copper water lines. So I'm going to replace all the hot and cold plumbing and modify the existing drain lines for the new tub location. I know, it looks like a lot of work, but if you get a big enough jackhammer, it only takes a few hours. And really, you can't hurt anything. Break out all the pieces of cement and toss them off to the side. Then you just take out enough dirt to do what you need to do. There is a drain right over here for where the toilet is, and the toilet is not scheduled to be moved. However, I needed to dig out around here because I needed to at least find the main coming in over here somewhere and tap into that, thus eliminating a lot of the old copper tubing. So the real interesting aspect over here, when you go underneath and you don't know where the piping really is, you can see that the main going to the bathtub and what was the old master shower comes out right there, and it connects over here somewhere. Now, when this wall went up, it was supposed to have been obviously right over the load bearing system on the foundation.
Let me see if I can explain this. Under the concrete slab is an internal reinforcing footing. That's an extra column of cement to help support the loads on the wall, because this wall is holding up parts of the roof. Inside this footing, and standard for residential construction, are two sections of steel reinforcement. In Florida, this is almost always a monolithic application, meaning the floor slab and footing were all poured in the same time as one part. So, I wasn't expecting to find the footing here. You can see the two steel reinforcement bars, and now I will need to spend more time with a jackhammer to remove all that extra footing material. Instead of the wall being placed directly over the supporting footing, it's offset nearly a foot. This is the drain vent hidden in the wall, and this is the water line for the toilet. So I know the main water line is running directly underneath it. If I take a cutaway view of the slab, this is what you're looking at. Theoretically, this is what should have happened. The load-bearing wall should be placed directly over the support footing. However, this is where the builder put the wall. In engineering, often we have the theoretical compromising the practical, and in this case, the offset is acceptable. Why? One reason, because the footing still supplies considerable support even if the load is placed 1 foot away. Secondly, this wall requires plumbing, and it's not practical to run plumbing through a footing. Now that I've excavated the bathroom plumbing, I'm starting to remove the old copper water lines. You can see the coupling I added for a leak repair several years ago. This is the main water line coming from the street. I was surprised to see that it was a half-inch copper line instead of the required three-quarter-inch copper line. The original builder must have run out of three-quarter-inch copper and snuck in a half-inch size. This is why home building, at least in the United States, has so many formal inspections today. Luckily, in this area, the water pressure is quite high, and the smaller diameter water line is still able to keep up with the household requirements. I had to expose the old cast iron drain pipe so I can have a better idea of how to run drain plumbing from the new bathroom position, and I still have another copper water line to take out. This is where the main water line continues for the rest of the house and includes the hot water line that comes back into the area from the hot water tank. I'm only replacing the copper tubing that I can reach and is within the scope of this remodel. So what do I do with the excavated dirt? I put it off just to the side so I could easily shovel it in when I'm done with the plumbing. I had it all done in about 4 hours. I'm replacing all the copper lines with PEX, P-E-X. That's just short for a long name, but it's a plastic type tubing. It comes in big rolls like this, white, red, or blue, so you can tell the difference, or the plumbers can tell the difference between hot and cold water. Using PEX is real easy for homeowners today, and it's the preferred material for all plumbers everywhere, almost all the time now, because it bends and it's lightweight, easy to use, very inexpensive. And homeowners love it today because they can use something like this, which is a push lock fitting. All you do is put it in there, push it, you're done. These are new to the big hardware stores, small hardware stores, wherever you look. But I've used these push lock fittings in my engineering applications 40 years ago. They were predominant. I used them all the time. I never had a failure. And so when I am doing a remodel, I want to retire for the evening and I'll continue the next day, and I want to turn the water back on to the main house. So I'll just slip this over, tighten this down, then we're all plugged up. I can turn the water back on, and then the next morning I just remove it and go back to work again. I've done what I need to do right now for this part of the bathroom. Let me switch my attention over to the bathtub and shower area, where I'm moving everything back 1 foot. This is the old bathtub drain. I'll need to dig up more dirt to expose the drain a little bit further down the run. I use my grinding wheel to cut the pipe, then attach a rubber coupling. This will allow me to switch to PVC for a new drain extension. PVC is a little bit easier to work with. You can see a dark smudge on the floor where the original wall was. On the other side was a closet, so I just moved the wall over a bit. I did sacrifice some closet space. Now, this is a load-bearing wall, so I'll show you how I did that. I placed some 2x4s to carry the loads from the beam that I'm going to construct to the floor. I did that on both sides. The beam is simply a composite of two 2x8s with a cut piece of plywood in the middle, and this should give me the total width of a standard 2x4, which is 3.5 inches thick. This is a short span, so I didn't feel the need to do any formal calculations as to the loads on the beam and the beam strength itself. If I did, I would have to take into consideration live loads and dead loads in pounds per square foot. Standard live loads would be about 30 pounds and dead loads would be about 20 pounds. Dead loads would be just the weight of the materials of the construction above the beam, and live loads would be things like snow, wind, sometimes furniture and people, if you're doing a second story. Depends on the situation. So I'm guessing my total design load should be around 50 pounds per square foot. Sure, I can calculate how many square feet the load-bearing wall is supporting. Then I would need to calculate the bending moment for a load-bearing beam. For that, I would need to know the fiber stresses of the wood type that I wanted to use. For southern pine, as an example, that's 1,750 pounds per square foot squared. If I was using southern pine wood, then I would find a beam thickness that will give me a greater bending moment number than the total predictable carrying loads. If I was concerned about stiffness as opposed to slight flexibility, then I would have to do additional calculations for modulus of elasticity and moments of inertia and perhaps a coefficient of elasticity. This really is all simple stuff. It sounds complicated, but really basic high school math is all you need, as long as you have access to all the engineering data about the strength of the wood or any construction material. However, it does take a while to plug all these numbers into well-established formulas. I might instead just use a standard safe span for wood headers chart on the back of many architectural educational books. I have one chart that simply states, for a 6-foot span, I am fine with a 4x8 wood beam. Okay, I'm really using a 3.5x8, but the plywood in the middle gives me extra load and stiffness capability, so I'm fine. I wanted to make the bathroom ceiling all the same height. I forgot about this air conditioning duct, and it's not going anywhere, so I'll need to find a creative way to place the wall around this. Before I tore down this bathroom wall, I constructed the new wall inside the closet from the other side. That wall was already framed, drywalled, and painted ahead of time in preparation for this project. Before I took out the bathroom wall framing, I put temporary bracing in place. That's a couple of 2x4 studs going to horizontal scrap 2x4s on the floor and the ceiling. This temporary bracing is offset a few inches from where the load-bearing beam will go, and this is a standard practice, so the ceiling maintains a means of support. You might notice that some of the wall studs in the new wall are positioned 90 degrees to the way you normally would see them. That's the long face against the wall. This is in preparation for a double wall and soundproofing. More on that later. In a bathroom area, you're bound to see segments of dry rot. When the frame is all open like this, it is very easy to replace.
See, what do we get here so far? The cable and power outlet for the closet TV. It's going up there eventually, a lot of cable lines. And since I needed room for putting the plumbing fixture, and I had load-bearing wall beams, which is these guys, supporting this beam up here, so I had a load-bearing beam I had to remove and put over here, and then when I figured out I had to do something with this, then I had to put another load-bearing beam over here to open up the space down here for fixtures. I got some of the framing done on top. That angle was a big nightmare, so I was glad to get that up. Of course, I put one lighting can up there just because I couldn't resist. So I brought it out this far. The rest of it hasn't been done yet. That's a little bit further down the line. And let's see what else. Gotta just put the box in there. I always get these boxes with the extra tab on the side because there's nothing worse than having this nailed and this nailed and having your switches and then they push in into the drywall. I hate that. So I get a little extra tab and I go through the trouble of building out this extra support, and this is rock solid. So no matter what you touch or switch, or it won't push in, it'll feel solid too. It'll have that certain sound when you hit the light switch. Now, since the sink or the bathtub is going in here, originally this is where the light switch was, and it's not to code because you can reach the light switch from the shower area. Now, we thought about putting this on the other side of the door and doing all kinds of different things, but we decided we're going to exercise our grandfather, which we're not really grandfathered in because we're redoing this, and once you redo it, then you're, you know, to this extent, then you're obligated by the code, but it just makes so much more sense to put it over here that I'm going to keep it there anyway.
I finished the rough plumbing, so now it's okay for me to shovel all the dirt back into the excavated area. I did the best I could to compact all the dirt, and I did drill some holes in the side of the concrete and epoxied in some wire support mesh. Under that, I placed a sheet of plastic, one, so that the moisture stays in the concrete longer and it helps cure stronger. Two, I didn't want the concrete to come in contact with any of the plumbing lines. This concrete was leveled with a straight 2x4, pretty much. I'll finish up the end area before this section gets set up too much so I can maintain a good mechanical bond. This is the water supply for the toilet. Many of the old framing studs had dry rot near the ground, so all that was removed to be replaced. Some of the wood is still missing because I wanted access to get the concrete back in areas that would otherwise be hard to reach. Note that I added wood strips to the existing studs. All required a different size filler strip to bring the wall studs flush and parallel. This was originally built in two sections with a divider in between, so there is no need for the original builders to be very accurate between the two sections. Additionally, the bump out for the vent stack was hidden behind some cabinets, so now this had to be accounted for. Getting some of the lowered ceiling height frame done. The original ceiling height was around 9 feet, and this will allow for some needed insulation. Notice I don't clean up or make pretty any more than necessary the areas that will never be seen again. Waste of time. I decided to frame in the air conditioning duct by angling the ceiling down. This gives it a more elegant transition rather than just a box framing. It's time to finish up the soundproofing on the wall. I have a 1-inch divided space inside the wall, and I do have the cement backer board on the surface of the framing right now for the tile. But I do have to do this in steps in order to fill that 1-inch gap in the wall with sand. I'm using a dustpan to help fill the sand up to the very top.
So I'm filling it the rest of the way. I got 3 chambers. This one's filled up already. Now, see if you can hear the difference. That's soundproofing.
I added some graphics to help show how I weave the internal sand filled wall so that it is a solid barrier. This was simply done using 2 thin sheets of plywood. I finished cutting and installing all the cement backer board for the area that I'm going to apply tile, except for the shower plumbing side. For that, I need to cut some precise holes. This creates quite a bit of dust, so I will do this in the shop.
And let me see. This is the board I cut. This is for the shower area. So you get the water control and the valve that goes off into the bathtub down below. I try to do a lot of this stuff in the shop so I don't get the house dirty, and this particular stuff is concrete. You know, to cut it was really nasty and it kicked up a lot of smoke, so I even did this outside.
I am now ready to slide the cast iron bathtub back into position. You will notice that there is some material moved from the backer board in order to gain the extra 1/8 inch clearance the bathtub needs. It was just a little too tight for me to fit the bathtub in there, so I took my grinder and removed just the amount of material I needed. I really hope I have the bathroom drains located with absolute precision, because it would be brutal to try to pull the bathtub back out again. If this had been a new house, I would not have placed the bathtub wall below the bathtub area, but I wanted soundproofing. And in new construction, I would have had access through the wall on the other side where I could do this plumbing after the tub was in position. For remodels, you don't have that option, unless you wanted to start opening up finished walls.
All right, moving the tub in. Still got a little ways to go. It's a nice tight fit, which is what I want. And I can only get it by hand to a certain point, and then the rest of the time I have to use a hydraulic jack. Unfortunately, my hydraulic jack was not working too well, so I had to take it out in the shop for the last hour and rebuild it. It's still not great, but it's doing the job. So I can go about 1/2 inch on this side, and I'll go 1/2 inch on the other side over here, and then I'll go back over here until I get a nice snug fit. Right now, still about 1 inch away, and hopefully my plumbing fittings line up, or else I'm in trouble. Alright, more fun.
With the tub in place, I was able to finish up the rough wiring and hang the lighting and the ventilation fan. I wanted to keep the original bathroom door because it matched the rest of the doors in the area of the house. The hinges were pretty nasty, so I had no problems replacing those with new ones. And now it's time to work on the door to the backyard. It's really important to have a nice clean straight lines cut into the concrete block so the door framing fits properly. I could rent a big chop saw that has massive grinding wheels on them for this purpose, or I can put a smaller grinding wheel on my old circular saw. My little circular saw did just fine, and I wasn't trying to cut the concrete all the way through. Instead, I just wanted about a 2-inch depth of a cut. This process throws up incredible amounts of dust. You'll notice I kept the window in place for the exterior work to keep the dust out of the room. Before I took down the interior block wall, I was able to finish the ceiling insulation. We are now prepping the bathtub for painting. We can't really remove this yellow color with the sander. We are only trying to rough up the surface so the paint has a better mechanical grip on the material. Yes, I said paint. I will explain that a little bit later. It's time to start punching out the outside of the concrete block wall. Again, we're maintaining a sealed environment from the elements until the last possible minute. It is very easy to remove one face of the concrete block and not affect the other side. We find that a very heavy short handle hammer is much easier to control than a long handled sledgehammer. Finally, it's time to cut the inside of the block. I don't need to cut through the concrete block as much. I know I need to score the blocks in order to get a fairly smooth surface, and that's about it. Cutting out the doorway was really a fairly easy process because the window was already in place, meaning there was already a support header holding the wall blocks up above. I already have the rough framing of the door up. I do have a preparatory way of attaching the wood to the concrete block in these kinds of applications. I don't purchase special fasteners, which can be rather expensive. Someday I may share that trick, but not today. However, I will share a tip that will substantially increase the structural integrity of this area. When making a doorway like this, I fill all the voids with expanding foam. The foam acts like a glue and substantially helps bond in areas where large gaps may exist. And as a byproduct, it helps insulate. You can see some of the foam extruding out. After it's dry, I will cut it flush to the wall.
Where's the drywall master?
Right here.
The drywall master. Tia's watching how things are. Tia, no. Oh.
Getting some of the tile work done. It goes pretty fast. There are lots of videos on laying tile, so I'm not going to cover this very much. I do like to use the spacers, but I don't like to leave the spacers under the grout. So I turn them sideways, and when the tiles are set, I merely pull them out by hand. I just made a special trip to the store to get this rounded drywall edging. I started to put up a regular 90-degree edging on this and decided it would look so much better rounded. The rounded edge cost maybe 3 times more than the standard 90-degree edge, but this is such a predominant corner, and this rounded part will substantially increase the elegance of the bathroom. I bought 4 ceramic trays to hold soap and bottles. We always seem to not have enough space for that. I've always liked the trays that were set into the corner better than the ones that stuck out in the middle of the walls. There's lots of different ways to hold the trays in position until they are bonded in place. I chose to use duct tape, and I would check these areas every 15 minutes or so to make sure that there wasn't any kind of sagging. Then I would add more tape, and then more tape, and then more tape with some wood scrap material to help support the trays from underneath. Not a very professional way to do this, but I knew this was iffy and kept my eye on things. Eventually, I made it work. The professional drywall installers will always put a priority on making sure the wall drywall fits snugly to the roof drywall. We opted to put up some decorative molding, so the ceiling to wall gap was not as critical. Next on the list is for the floor tile, the same tile as used in the shower. We like the consistency. Too many materials tend to break up the space, making it look smaller. I spent a lot of time figuring out where the solid pieces of the tile should go and where the cut pieces of the tile should go. And this is where you should spend most of the time allocated for any tile job. After those decisions were made, the tiles went down very quickly. I typically do the whole tiles first and let them set up. Then I'll go back and take my time with fitting the cut tiles. Now I'm preparing the tub for painting. Not only did we sand the tub, but we gave it a chemical wash to help remove any buildup in the pores. Since I'm using a spray, I am carefully masking off the area. You can have a professional come in and resurface your tub, or you can buy special tub resurfacing kits. The problem with this approach is that the chemical sprays are really harsh and bad for your home environment. Okay for factory applications, not so good for applications in your house. Instead, I will simply spray this with a can of epoxy paint from the hardware store. I've used the stuff on my boats with great success, and it's extremely economical. The catch is that you need to let it dry for 2 to 3 weeks, and it still won't be as tough as the original surface. You will probably still need to reapply this paint every 2 to 3 years on the wear surfaces. However, if your bathtub doesn't get much use, you can get professional results that will last much longer. The application of the masking tape will decide how successful the results are. Of course, the masking tape needs to be removed before the paint dries too much. Naturally, I've made some errors. I had placed the plumbing in the middle of the space for the countertop. There were drawers in the way, and I decided it was easier to open up the drywall and move the plumbing a little rather than modifying the cabinet.
Even though the sink is off the center line, it's got some cabinets on one side, so everything shifted over to the left. All right, so no problem. So two valves, or one valve in the drain, here and here are clear, not a problem. But the other valve came out over here, which was in the way, and I can cut out the cabinet for that. And I decided, no, I'll just cut away some of the drywall, I can patch it up, and I'll jog it over with a couple 90 degree elbow bends, and we're all set. And this is what I'm doing. Not a problem. So I took this connector off. Unfortunately, this goes to a plastic piece, and these have to be tightened pretty tight. So I took it off, and I made an opening big enough so I can gain access to it. And when I was taking this off, I heard a little noise, and naturally, let me get the light in there. Hey, we see something down there. There's a part I need right there. I can't reach it. Now I don't want to put any more holes into it. So luckily, I reached into my toolbox years ago. I had an issue, and I have, let's see if it comes into view, this guy. Watch this. Ha ha. So I should be able to reach this down in here and grab what I need. All right, I'll get busy with that.
Putting the toilet back is always a sign of nearing completion. The two bolts that hold the toilet down are usually tough to align through the toilet mounting holes. With one person doing this, the bolts almost always flop to the side. This is an old trick to use stiff paper and punch the bolts through. The paper holds the bolts straight up for alignment, and once the toilet is in place, the paper is just easily pulled out.